This is a production of PBS 39.
Gentlemen, before we move on to another question from a viewer, let's take a moment to talk about healthcare acquired infections. It's a piece of the governor's plan, but my question, and obviously it's an expensive part, what do we do? I have an uncomfort level from someone who runs a hospital saying that the state can enact legislation that tells Dr. Sussman how to run his hospital better. That just seems difficult to understand, George. How can we, I recognize the goal is to reduce about $3.5 billion in costs because of healthcare acquired infections, but how does the state work well with the healthcare institutions?
Well, we're all in this together. What we want medical facilities and nursing facilities to do is to report to us on a regular basis the number of healthcare acquired infections that they have. We want to help them find ways to be able to reduce the number of such infections. In the year 2005, there was about 2,500 people in Pennsylvania that died as a result of healthcare acquired infections. And what the governor's legislation that actually was passed and signed earlier this year, Act 52, does is it provides and addresses both surveillance as well as transparency of hospital or healthcare acquired infections. What we want to be able to do is to help every facility develop and implement an infection control plan. We know that facilities the same as we would all like everyone to be able to go for a visit or be in a nursing facility and not have to worry about infections. And we believe together, by working together, we'll be able to minimize those infections.
Dr. Sussman, I know you have an in-depth infection control plan at Lehigh Valley Hospital and Health Network. And I know one of the things that we talked about probably last year on this program was just the increased hand washing, and having hand washing stations outside of more areas of your facility can help cut that down. What concerns do you have from any sort of state legislation?
Well, you know, I think there's always this balance in healthcare between regulation and making sure that that's both well-intended, not just well-intended, but is inclusive. And I applaud George and the governor for seeing that physicians, nurses, and others have had a voice, and I think are listened to as this legislation rolls out. Clearly, there are some basic things that all healthcare facilities need to do. Hand washing, both before and after you see the patient, so key. And in fact, if you look overall, we don't do that well. You know, probably if you look through all hospitals in the state, maybe 60-70% are the compliance rates. We can do better. Not an easy thing to do, to change habits. Think about anybody's habits. Certainly when I was trained as a physician up in Boston 30 years ago, that was not something you just routinely did. Lots of other issues, but as people get sicker and their immune systems drop, we need to ever be more vigilant about taking care of folks, because it's a heck of a lot easier to prevent those infections in the first place than to treat them after the fact.
And pay for them, which leads us right into a question that we have, another question from our viewer. It's an emailed question, and this one comes from Esther Lee, who is the president of the NAACP in Bethlehem. She writes, what can be done to help senior citizens on fixed incomes afford quality health care insurance? Well, Dr. Mascalis, this one's gone to you.
Well, Highmark continues to work closely at both the state and the federal level to identify ways that we can develop products that are consistent with federal guidelines that are affordable. Also, many times seniors don't always have issues with hospitalization coverage, but it's office visits, physical therapy, and especially pharmacy benefits that can be very expensive and can have a significant impact. And one of the things that we are doing is finding ways in which we can work closely with individuals within the pharmaceutical industry and elsewhere to develop products that allows greater access for the types of medications and services that are needed. Americans are living longer, and they're utilizing services for a longer period of time, and therefore we want to make sure that we are identifying ways to make those resources available for those longer periods of time.
Dr. Sussman, before we run out of time, I want to take a minute to talk about the need for more primary care physicians. You alluded to it earlier. As we have more people getting access to insurance, there are already some primary care physicians in our area that aren't accepting new patients. Is there a critical need to get more out there?
Well, I think that there is a critical need and a developing and increasing need in Pennsylvania and across the nation for more physicians. If you look since 1960, really the number of slots in medical school has barely budged. Back when we had 200 million people in this country, we were graduating 16,000 MDs a year. Now with 330 million people in the country, we're graduating about 17,000. There are plans to increase that number, and there are also increases in osteopathic schools, increases in offshore schools. And we need to see how we incent people not just to go into specialty areas, an orthopedic surgeon, a cardiac surgeon, a cardiologist, but also be that good primary care physician. That has to do with issues in terms of stresses on the career. It has to do with compensation. In fact, one
Very
earns
little
a lot
time,
less.
Dr. Sussman.
So something that we can do a lot better in Pennsylvania than we're currently doing.
Wonderful. Well, this is an issue that we could discuss for days, but I'm afraid we've run out of time. I'd like to thank all of our panelists for joining us this evening. We appreciate your time so very much. George Hoover from the State Department of Insurance, Dr. Elliot Sussman from Lehigh Valley Hospital, Dr. Muscalis from Highmark Blue Shield. We appreciate it. We hope this evening was just the start of your research into proposed healthcare changes. For more information, please head to our website at WLVT.org, where you'll find links to many different resources to help empower you about this complex topic. Thanks so much for joining us. We appreciate your time. Good night.
Funding for this program is made possible by the Pennsylvania Public Television Network Commission and by the members of PBS 39. Thank you.
Building a workforce system called PA Career Link Lehigh Valley. Training the workforce to meet employer hiring needs, connecting employers with workers, and workers with jobs. Lehigh Valley Workforce Investment Board.
RCN and RCN4, partnering with PBS 39 and committed to bringing quality local television programming to the residents of the Lehigh Valley. RCN, cable, phone, and internet.